परिचय। अक्सर सोचती हूँ मैं, अक्सर सोचती हूँ जंगलों को
Buongiorno a tutti, e comincerei subito con una poesia. Jacinta Johar, we would like you to start with a poem, a poetry of yours, and we will translate it in Italian just for people to understand. Thank you. Yeah. Johar, so this poem is Parichay. अक्सर सोचती हूँ जंगलों को देखते हुए, धरती के किसी कोने पर जब लोग बात कर रहे होते हैं हर तरह की आजादी पर, तब जंगलों के अंदर लोगों को अपने ही घरों में घुसने से पहले क्यों देना पड़ता है बैठाए गए पहरेदारों को हर बार अपना परिचय?
Identificazione. Spesso penso, guardando la giungla, che mentre chissà dove nel mondo la gente parla di ogni genere di libertà, perché nella giungla la gente, prima di entrare nelle proprie case, è costretta a identificarsi, a dire chi è, alle guardie appostate?
Allora, buongiorno a tutti. Allora, oggi abbiamo l'onore di poter conversare con la poetessa e attivista per i diritti della popolazione Adivasi in India. Al momento è un attimo sparita dalla connessione, immagino che non abbia un'ottima connessione da dove si trova, però ci raggiungerà subitissimo, sono sicura. Intanto possiamo andare avanti dicendo che abbiamo deciso di invitarla qui oggi perché troppo spesso utilizziamo delle parole che sono vuote, vuote di significato, sono vanificate, troppo spesso parliamo senza veramente la pienezza né della parola né dell'azione che porta con sé. Ed è per questo che abbiamo appunto voluto invitare Giacinta, perché è una testimonianza, è un esempio, che attraverso la sua parola, l'utilizzo della sua parola, innalza l'importanza dell'azione. Quindi io non mi dilungherei di più di questo e lascio la parola a Maria Elena che ci introdurrà molto brevemente, qual è il contesto in cui Giacinta lavora?
Buongiorno a tutti, vorrei ricollegare all'intervento. In effetti le parole di Giacinta non sono dei corpi sterili buttati su carta, ma vivono della stessa linfa vitale che scorre in tutti noi, ovvero negli esseri umani e nella natura. Chi è Giacinta Kerchetta? Giacinta è una poetessa e un'attivista originaria del Jharkhand. Lei appartiene all'etnia Oraon, che sarebbe di lingua Kuruk, ma in realtà la sua lingua materna è la Hindi. Studiò Mass Communication a Ranchi, che è la capitale del Jharkhand, e divenne giornalista proprio perché interessata a battersi per i diritti delle comunità adivasi, scrivendo anche per il giornale Prabhat Khabar, che letteralmente significa il notiziario del mattino. Però si rese presto conto del reale disinteresse o, come dice lei, della pigrizia di questi giornalisti che spesso non impugnano in maniera forte, in maniera interessata, la causa degli adivasi. Quindi decise di mettersi in proprio, divenne una giornalista freelance e in questo modo riuscì a dedicarsi completamente alla causa adivasi. Ed è proprio qui che fa il suo ingresso trionfale la poesia, perché dove non arrivava il giornalismo, arrivava la poesia. Questo perché la poesia ha la forza di vibrare in consonanza con le corde intime del cuore, con l'anima delle persone, e quindi raggiunge l'essere umano universale in quanto essere umano. Adesso alcuni cenni storici, insomma, per capire chi sono gli Adivasi e quindi perché si batte Giacinta. Chi sono gli Adivasi? Letteralmente Adivasi significa gli abitanti originari, ovvero si riferisce quindi a tutte quelle minoranze etniche tribali che vivono sul territorio indiano. Si tratta appunto di molteplici culture, molteplici tradizioni, lingue, religioni che hanno subito storicamente grandi abusi da parte delle maggioranze. E guardando qualche dato, secondo il Census of India del 2011, che è stato l'ultimo grande censimento, queste comunità ricoprono l'8,6% della popolazione totale, quindi oltre 100 milioni di persone, che è un numero ingente. Il governo indiano definisce queste comunità come Scheduled Tribes, che letteralmente significa le tribù riconosciute, le tribù programmate. E questo perché, questo riferendosi appunto non tanto e non solo a un fattore di diversità culturale, di diversità linguistica, di tradizioni e religioni, ma anche al fatto che queste popolazioni spesso sono relegate sia dal punto di vista geografico, sia dal punto di vista di arretratezza economica. E quindi queste popolazioni oggi infatti subiscono enormi abusi che le costringono a una lotta quotidiana per riappropriarsi delle proprie terre che vengono sfruttate. Vengono sfruttate in particolare, per fare qualche esempio, insomma, dei motivi principali, delle cause principali, vengono sfruttate ad esempio dalle grandi infrastrutture, dalle grandi opere edilizie. Infatti molto spesso queste opere, queste infrastrutture, vengono fatte su territori abitati da popolazioni adivasi e non solo in realtà, e quindi questi diventano, la foresta, queste terre diventano dei veri e propri cantieri in cui queste stesse popolazioni che abitavano questa terra diventano dei lavoratori, vengono sfruttati per lavorare e sfruttare questa terra. Un altro esempio, poi non mi dilungherei di più, lascerei la parola proprio a Giacinta, l'esempio delle lotte, degli scontri tra i Naxaliti, che sono gruppi di combattenti maoisti, e la polizia, che avviene sempre in territori, in territori dove abitano queste popolazioni. Ma adesso vorrei appunto lasciar parlare Giacinta e vorrei iniziare proprio con le prime domande, visto che è tornata con noi.
Eccola. Quindi, Johar, Giacinta, I would start with the first question.
Johar.
Which is about ecology. We always hear about this word ecology. Yeah. Nowadays, the words ecology and sustainability enter in the common use vocabulary. They are used by every newspaper, magazine, by every government. And sometimes we find these words on products, even on products coming from multinational corporations. Too often we hear talking about ecology in terms of quantity, and not in terms of what it really is, nature. Governments start politics using economic and mathematic concerns. We are too often distant from real life, from nature. So we can say that policies change over time, while nature does not follow the political processes. In this relation between Earth and human beings, it feels something is missing, maybe the sacred bond between the two. How should, and this is the real question actually, how should a human being interrelate with nature and his surrounding environment, considering that we need nature while nature does not need us? Should we first relate with our inner nature and understand that we are intimately connected with our environment? And the last question about this topic is, what is actually Adivasi community's vision on this matter?
Thank you.
Every religion talk about nature, and every religion offer you a perspective to understand nature. But to regard nature as a religion is a totally different perspective altogether. So who takes nature as their religion? And it is the Adivasis. If the world is today talking about protecting nature, then the world should also be concerned about protecting the people who are the closest to nature and understand it the most deeply, and they are the Adivasi. But what are people engaged in at present? They believe that the Adivasi peoples will get eliminated anyway. So before that happens, it is best to collect and conserve their knowledge system, wisdom, arts, crafts, etc. The non-Adivasi society are engaged in appropriating whatever they can from the Adivasi people. But some people are not concerned about standing in solidarity with the Adivasi people in their struggle and resistance, or making any effort to learn from Adivasi people about their worldview. These are not the world's concern today. So this is also not the concern of any organized religion. Nature is only present in a small way in the tenets of organized religion, and mainly these religions teach to look at nature as a commodity for livelihood security. But for the Adivasi, the death of nature is also the death of humanity. Nature does not mean only trees and plants, or the whole but the whole universe of life system, like humans, animals, plants, trees, water, lands, etc. Every life form resolves equally around nature, and all are equal in the Adivasi worldview. But in the non-Adivasi worldview, humans are the top of the life system and have an economic relationship with animals, plants, insects, water, lands, which come after humans in a pyramid in hierarchy. Therefore, non-Adivasi, even if they worship trees, they do not stand up in defense of the destruction of forest, animals, and Adivasi societies. And this is because the whole of the life system of nature is not part of the religion. Based on the Adivasis, the whole of nature and all its life system are part of the religion, and hence they will stand up to defend any part of nature that may be threatened. This is the difference between organized religion and Adivasi spirituality, and Adivasi spirituality or
Tornerai in un momento, la connessione purtroppo è nelle zone montane dove si trova lei, sono difficili da connettere molto spesso, quindi la aspettiamo volentieri. Nel frattempo colgo la sua riflessione, la morte dell'umano e eccola. Niente, sto zitta.
My network is not good. Here
you are.
It was heavily raining today. So there is a relationship between Adivasi and nature, and they see nature as their home and a part of themselves that is not separate from them. You say that people cannot live without nature, but nature can live without people. But Adivasi people believe that everything is connected to each other and hence interdependent. And if in that network of connections, even one link breaks down, the whole system will collapse. That is why a crisis in any link in the web of nature affects humans as much it affects other species also. Humans cannot escape this reality. The so-called developed world has never tried to give any attention to this reality. As a result, now the whole world is suffering from the crisis that began with the breakdown of one link in the life system of nature. This is This is how I understand it.
Okay. So now we can connect to the theme of roots. So how important and vital is the discourse of roots in a world dominated by the liberal ideology, which infiltrates everywhere in the territory, and which legitimizes also the abuses and the poisoning of others' roots? So in your opinion, how important is to consider and protect and safeguard these roots, which are naturally differentiated by nature?
Adivasi believes that diversity is nature itself, you know, and this is a reality. When a society does not accept diversity, then it uses its power to impose its own views, cultures, beliefs on others. Diversity is like the root of nature. So anyone destroying diversity also destroys nature itself and also the Adivasi peoples and roots also. So Adivasi people believe that tribal ideology and its thinkers help in maintaining the Adivasi people believe that liberal ideology and its thinkers help in maintaining the dominant and powerful oppressors of the marginalized society. This fact is best explained through the words of a leader from Niyamgiri mountain of Odisha, Lodo Sikoka. He says that if bauxite was found under the Jagannath temple in Puri in Odisha, the mining will under the temple never will allowed, and the liberals will never demand that the mining under the temple be undertaken. But when there is bauxite under our sacred lands, there is no second thought in evacuating us from those lands, what he says. So people think like that liberals believe that everyone has to be taken along in any process of transformation, but all those who join a struggle come with their own power capacity, like higher education, socially upward class or upper caste, and some come to the struggle with none of these but with a lot of knowledge and wisdom. In that case, the people with power must learn to give space to the latter and move back so that the people with knowledge can be the forefront of the struggle. This has to be the first concern of everyone, but that is not happening. So liberals want to collaborate with everyone in a struggle and end up taking along people who have betrayed the very resistance movement they want to stand with. But in Lodo Sikoka's words, anyone who has betrayed her or his own community can never be part of the community ever again. I have never been able to forget these words of Lodo. Just to take along everyone, Lodo says that we cannot accept a person with his or her past of betrayal and lies. This he feels is an important position in their fight to save their lands and identity. So whatever resistance is happening in the world, it is mostly centered around grabbing as much resource profits as they can and maintaining their dominance. And it is only the Adivasi who are fighting to save nature and their roots, and hence they are resisting to save whole humanity.
Thank you, because this is really interesting, because talking about liberals and liberalism is something that even for us, it's important. And hearing about the testimony of Adivasi society, it might be important even for us to move and fight for our own world here, which is connected to yours there. And that's why liberalism as the main oppressor nowadays of even all diversities. And it's really important, this thing that you just said, actually. What I would like to ask you now is exactly concerned about the roots of liberalism, which is property and land enclosure. Because people, liberals especially, are convinced that gaining property has no limits and only rights, and they take it granted with through money. So they think that their money can buy everything, and that they could have no any limit because they don't have limit in that gaining of money, and money is their language. What do you think about this? Do you think that this is a provocation, actually? Do you think that the land belongs to those who work it or live it, or to those who buy it, exactly legitimized by the liberal ideology?
What I have learned from people, people of grassroots, the people who inhabit a land, develop a relationship. The people who inhabit a land develop a relationship with that land, and they consider this relationship sacred and divine. They put all their efforts and knowledge in making it beautiful and better. They do this irrespective of whether they have any ownership over it or not. In fact, this idea of ownership has been brought about by the state because it sees land as a commodity to be bought and sold in the market. And the liberal ideology said same view about that. They do not value the sacred relationship of land with humans. So land does not belong to person who cultivates it, builds a house on it, or has bought it, what Adivasi people believe. Land belongs to the person who has a relationship with it. Some believe that land belongs to the person who labors on it. But Adivasi do not really understand this, because these days lands can be cultivated with machine also. The Adivasi believe that before the farmers cultivated the land with machines, it was they who created the land, made it ready for the farming, for growing food, and hence those who prepared these lands fit for growing food have the first right over these lands. The Adivasi's relationship with land is not just limited to growing food on it. Marx too viewed had land as a resource, but the Adivasis see land as their mother, which is totally different perspective. They also see their ancestral spirit in this land, their deities in this land, and they believe that they are surrounded with their benevolent spirits who protect this land. But the left has not been able to emphasize this with this view and land, you know. So Adivasi has this kind of a connection with land, and it is not just a commodity for them, but very strong this spirituality connection with land and with forest, you know, and that I think so-called mainstream never understands that, with this connection. So this Adivasi spirituality, they don't want to talk about, or maybe they think it is one kind of myth or something, you know, but which is living reality for Adivasis. That is reality for them. That is truth, and that's it. They never question on it, you know, what they are living and with whom they are living and what kind of relations they have with lands. that is reality for them, and that is enough for them, you know.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Jacinta. I really loved when you talked about mother. Actually, we want to to connect to this theme of being women. I want to ask you about the role of women in this struggle, in this fight for protecting the nature. So which is the role of Adivasi women and of women in general? The ecological activism for land, for nature, and for people, of course. We have heard of, there are many examples actually of women. It reminds me, for example, the Chipko movement of women, or many other women who are connected to these fights. So what do you think? Does it differ from the male fight for nature? Mm-hmm. And how? Mm-hmm. And what are the modalities? Which are the different modalities?
So what I have understand, I will explain that earlier among Adivasi societies, people cleared land as per their need and was held
Abbiamo perso ancora la connessione.
Era la pioggia.
Esatto, ma tornerà. Sì.
E nel frattempo la questione delle donne, se Maria Elena vuoi fare due parole rispetto a questo in italiano per far capire anche di che cosa si tratta e il motivo per cui sono le donne nelle zone rurali dove le popolazioni di Vasi vivono a implicarsi principalmente e in prima persona nella lotta. Ecco,
è tornata. Eccola.
Sì, si sta riconnettendo.
I'm really sorry. Hello. Yeah. So I was saying that earlier among Adivasi societies, people cleared lands as per their need, and was held commonly without any individual control over the lands. With the coming of the nation state and land was given an economic value, the idea of ownership and the retained control, the idea of transfer of property from one generation to another was created, and this was how individual land ownership idea came into being. And the transfer of land was passed on from one male to another male, higher. And thus the institution of marriage and family also came into being. This idea of the private ownership of property was not there among Adivasi. And this idea was further supported by organized religions like Hinduism or Christianity. All these oppressed women are, you know, all these oppressed women for generations. Mm-hmm. But now women have begun questioning the nation state, the family, religion, and marriage, and are demanding for this to change. But women have had to be militant in order to make this change happen, since the institutions that oppressed them have amassed and consolidated huge amounts of power since generations. And this is also true that working class women, Dalit women, and Adivasi women have been at the forefront of this militant resistance. Educated middle class and home confined women have really not contributed that much to this militant resistance. But when we say militant, we do not mean women who have taken up arms to resist patriarchy. If women have felt that need to take up arms to fight for their freedom, from oppression, then we stand by them too. And we also stand by women who have used all their power to fight for their freedom from all forms of oppression. That is why women resistance has always been militant, because the patriarchal oppressive power structure does not respect, you know, discussions, dialogue, and hence with these strategies, power cannot be, you know, challenged. So women are more resilient. Women can fight back harder when they are connected to their land. Women too have betrayed these resistance, but their numbers always been lesser than the men who have betrayed this resistance, their resistance. And maybe that is why land was never recorded in the name of women, since they would not sell out their lands to corporates so easily as men do. But now resistance has to also give way to creation of a new social order, a community which carries forward whatever is beautiful and resilient in Adivasi societies.
Yeah. Thank you. Because you have been talking about militant resistance, and yeah. We would like now to ask you about the main activity of your militancy, which is the militancy of poetry.
Because you are
a poet and you compose poems through which you express messages that, like powerful spirits, detach from yourself as an individual and fly, actually, to reach other people's hearts and minds, of course. And your poetry encourages people to think and then act, actually. Actually, poetry and poetical languages nowadays are defined only too much as art without action. And your testimonials is actually important, because your art is not just art, it's art in action, and it's deeply connected with your own self and your land and the people you are fighting for. Yeah. And the words are powerful, and such is also the way in which you, as a poet, interweave them to create the final effect. So the question is, what do you think is the role of your words nowadays, especially in this society, which not always understands poetry and not always understands the meaning of the words, actually?
So I remember Meena Kanda Swami's, a famous writer, once said that for a woman, life itself is a struggle. When women share their stories, poetry uniquely has the capability and power to portray the struggle of women in fewer words, you know. So most often poetry is considered as a soft tool of, you know, resistance, but it depends where are the words and stories originating from, whether it is a battlefield or a drawing room. It depends upon that. All that I trying to do through poetry is bring forth the story, the worldview, critic, resistance, and resilience of my Adivasi people. It's really important we broaden the scope and language of poetry. Some of my friends and comrades believe that poetry and its sharp usage of words has opened up their inner inner conscience more than prose. And they also believe that this form of communication, particularly using metaphors, is the closest way of describing and understanding Adivasi worlds. Because, you know, Adivasi talks in metaphor. When you hear their stories, you know, they will talk about lion, they will talk about, you know, wolf, and you know, in this kind of metaphor they put one story, human story, they won't take, you know, name, but they put in this, they use, you know, metaphor. So my well-wishers or readers, those who are from grassroots, they are reading my poetry, they feel that this metaphor is very close to Adivasis, very close to Adivasi, because they have very you know, they use this metaphor, they use also, you know, to talk about their struggle or to share their stories, they use metaphor. So they feel very connected to my poetry, and they understand, you know, what I'm saying in metaphor, and they feel like important and through poetry, you know. So through poetry also, through poetry I'm sharing different stories. Every poetry has, you know, behind every poetry is behind, has one long story. So they feel very important, and I am not writing poetry far from means I'm trying to live with people and where struggle is going on. So when poetry comes from this battlefield, it will be, surely it will be very different, and it will be very powerful. So and I feel like poetry should be like that, you know, because you can't separate poetry with politics, with, you know, with the fight, or with this core value of humanity, you know, and without participating or without standing, people, those who are in this world fighting, you know, to save humanity, if I'm not with them and I'm writing, it means I'm cheating myself, you know. I'm cheating people. I'm not honest with my writings. So, and I feel like in so-called mainstream, this is very, you know, mess up. Like whether you are honest with your writings or not, it doesn't matter, you know. If one book published and if you got some award, that makes you you know, precious in so-called mainstream. But for Adivasi, they feel, what is opportunity? They say if your opportunity, your achievements, that is not helping people, those who are fighting in land, that what is the meaning of this kind of achievement, you know? So achievement also, they say in collective way, not one person is achieving something, but through one person, how community is achieving something, no? So nowadays I feel they say, how you judge yourself, you can judge like that. If that achievement, who is giving, why he is giving, and how that achievement is, you know, beneficial for people, how it is helping people, you know. So when poetry is very grassrooted, with from which stands in battlefield, that all this kind of quality, like dedication, you know, honesty, automatically it will come, and you will feel so connected to nature also, you know. So you this all, and you will slowly, you will be become very you know, like your you will grow inside also, you will grow through poetry, you will become more, you know, more human being. So means my experience is with poetry like that. It is like that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jacinta. It was really, really, really interesting. And actually, words are important, and also the way you use, the way you actually interweave them together, they create something. And what they create is a message to people, is a message to a humanity, which is also which goes beyond also the borders. So I want to talk with you now about the Matrubhasha, so the native language.
The
native language is really important, because when you talk, you start from your native language. Even even if you learn other languages, you speak other languages, then you start from that. You start from that Matrubhasha. So in what we were talking, so in the Adivasi context, how is it important, how much is it important to express and to know and to keep the words of the Matrubhasha to express and to not to use it, but to have it as a resilient instrument to safeguard the intimate part of yourself, like not to cheat to yourself, you were telling. And I completely agree. You don't have to cheat yourself. So, Matrubhasha, how is it for you?
Yeah. So, I grew up in city also and village also, means everywhere. So, I have learned different language and mainstream, so-called mainstream language also. And to protect and save our mother tongue, it was very hard in so-called mainstream society or in, you know, in city, because this language has now become tool to get a job or your, you know, to for livelihood. So my mother stopped talking mother tongue at home, because he was thinking if they will not learn mainstream language, they it will be hard for their survival, for our survival. But when I started searching my roots, you know, if I'm Adivasi, where is my roots, you know? So when I started searching my roots, then I feel that I should go back to my mother tongue and what it says, you know, I should search, you know. So when I went back to my mother tongue, I realized that how this language creates or shape, language gives shape your brain, you know, your whole behavior, and then in which society you are living, your whole behavior is getting shaped by this language. And when I started learning my mother tongue, it is totally different from this Indo-Aryan language. So their characters, their behavior, you know, their environment, and power of woman, that is totally very different. And how my own mother tongue, it is Kuduk. I am Urang Adivasi. I belong to Urang Adivasi community. So how they, you know, see through language, gender equality, and about transgender also, you know. So these totally whole behaviors are very different from mainstream language. And I realized it has given me so much growth inside, or it has changed my understanding also when I went. And then I started learning, and I started practicing this script of my mother tongue. And now trying every day, I'm trying to read one chapter of, you know, some magazine in my mother tongue. So one day maybe if I'll, I'll be able to speak or maybe convey my message in my mother tongue. So I want to talk about this mother tongue, that every language has a mother. So every language is mother tongue. It might not be yours, but it is certainly somebody else. We shall never think of own mother as ugly or savage. The same way we cannot call somebody else mother also ugly or savage, you know. We don't have the moral ground or rights to say like that. Means for any language, I don't I criticize, but never I don't have feeling for other language also. So language aren't formed from the sky. Except in India, the ruling Hindutva party claims that Sanskrit is language which only God talks, you know. But Adivasi people, for language, they don't believe like that. They believe that language are formed when people and geography meet, live and dialogue with each other. Adivasi languages are born out of this continuous interaction with nature. Every species, with birds or trees, have something to offer, something we could learn from. So this, you know, so this all bonding has created, you know, mother tongue this language. Constant observation and dialogue with the nature is one of the most important reason behind originating of thousands of languages. And that is why Adivasi people say, when a language dies, the land dies. And when land dies, the language dies with it too. So you see, that is why we Adivasi people are against displacement and land grabbing. We fight till the hilt to protect our land and language. History is a testimony of this. Across the world, many government has tried to displace Adivasi people out of their language, music, dance, forms and lands, which are all interconnected. Once people are displaced, the society disintegrates. What follows is death of a life world, a worldview, a language, a way of seeing the world. Displacement promotes uninformity, not diversity. It's educationist, and we opposed it. So in Odisha, many Adivasi communities believe that their fight against state or corporate invasion of land is not only a fight to protect lands, forest, water, and mountains, but equally important fight to protect their language, culture, and worldview also. So language originates from nature, and nature is what we believe as sacred. Our only way of communication between the inner and outer is through our language, which is sacred. My mother tongue is Kudu, and I'm trying to connect, you know, through my language with nature. That connection I'm trying to, you know, trying to do. So.
Thank you.
You know, because all this that you said actually forms the roots of a human being, yeah. Language, diversity. Yeah. Being a human means this. And our own identity, it's based on our mothers, which are also our languages, as you just said. The last two questions is because we were concerned also about talking with you about your activity, and we were wondering why we should talk to an Italian public in this moment, for example, about your activity, what would be the use. So Maria Elena will ask you a question about this, but before asking about this question, which is more really important for us, because we need to understand also what we can do in here according to this, we will ask you which are your current activities, because now you are in the villages around Ranchi, And in this period, you're working with the communities of these villages and the surroundings in Jharkhand. So what is the schedule of your activities and which aspects are you focusing on? And Maria Elena was talking about Matrubasha, mother tongue, actually, as a crucial aspect. Is it a crucial aspect also in your teachings in the villages?
In my childhood, like, I have struggled a lot to get, you know, good education. So when I grown up and when I started, a job, and I was not satisfied with that, means I was trying to this writing or this, you know, as a journalist, I wanted to, I was searching that how creatively I can do it. So I have left that. And I was realizing and strongly I was feeling that every Adivasi girl has, you know, same kind of journey which I have done, and same kind of struggle which I have, you know, gone through. So it was in my mind that I have to work with Adivasi adults and girls. And So 5 years ago, I have chosen one small village, and continuously I started visiting, you know, girls, you know, started talking to their family, and then simply I started sharing, you know, with sharing, they can share their experience. And this sharing is also, you know, it was very hard for them because everybody was all the time, they were crying. It was very hard to share. So I started with this sharing, and then I started brought this discussion that I asked them that did you notice that every girl has same story, same struggle, but in one village they are in every corner with same story, same struggle, and they are not together. You know, as a woman also, why we are in one village, in one place, why we are separate, why we are separate from each other. And then girl has realized with one story, with one struggle, when we come together, you know, it brings one kind of power, one kind of confidence to fight, you know, with your problems. And then I realized only, you know, we talk about among girls, it is not, it will also not work. Then I started talking with their parents, and then whole village, they said about this issue, that why there is gap, you know, parents and children, why girls are going city, and, you know, and parents, sometimes they don't know where is that girl. So this, when this discussion I put in front of whole village, they have realized that gap is, you know, becoming older people in village and younger generation, how this gap is becoming, you know, more deep. And then they realize that how we can talk about this is also one issue which we have to see. You know, and then a small step in every house, they started taking, like, at least at home, they can give them a place or environment for study, you know. So first I started like that. And then later I realized what kind of education we need. Because when I started visiting Adivasi areas, I met some other friends, those who are working to make one pedagogy in, you know, Adivasi, with Adivasi worldview. Because what education we are getting now, it is very higher, it is, you know, hierarchy based or very Brahmanical. And that won't, it is not going to solve, you know, Adivasi problems, you know. So we started thinking this kind of mainstream education won't bring freedom for us, you know. So how we can make pedagogy of, you know, our with our worldview, how we can make for children. So we are continuously working on it, and now, like from 3-4 years, I thought this language is also very important, because sometimes, like this language, you know, it connects sudden. It gives one kind of connection through language. Sometimes we don't know anybody's or a strange village, but this language becomes very strong tool to get connected with them, you know. So I started. I have these all issues. I talked with village people. They have made one small organization in village. It is not registered, but some very active people are there. They are working in daytime and they are working for society in evening time, you know, like that. So we decided that in Adivasi area, in some hill area or interior, small village, it is very far, in very far place. So we thought how we can connect them. And then we started this tribal festival. So in every year, they started gathering like 20 or 25 villages together. So first it was 10 village, and then 15 village, and then 20 village. And then we started talking about this education, that now and then it's still we are working this pedagogy for tribal children, and apart that mainstream education, in parallel how we can get that kind of, you know, syllabus or that kind of education also, which tells our story, you know, our history, you know, and our struggle, our land. Because tribal girls or boys, children, when they are going to school, they are, when they are coming back to village, they are full with, you know, this mainstream idea and mainstream use this development concept, and you know, they are so much against with their parents. So this education is one kind of tool. Tool to destroy Adivasi peoples, and they, through this education, they help through this education many Adivasi new generation also, and people also becoming tool to destroy their own people, you know. So I believe that parallel this with Adivasi worldview, that kind of pedagogy, that kind of education system we need, and how I can work for you know, this. So like 2-3 states youth, those who are active in village area, in grassroots, we are trying to connect them, we are trying to talk to them. So that's why all the time, you know, I from city I run to grassroots, and I meet people, I meet friends, and we are trying together and make one, you know, syllabus or something, which in different place with adults and Adivasi youth, you know, or girls, we can work. So still we are working on it from last few months. And in my area, I'm trying to share my story, my writings, you know, my thoughts. In village to village, I just go and gather girls, and we, you know, to give them you know, this kind of idea also. And it is helping me a lot, because in interior place, even girls, they don't know that if something is, they have confusion or something they want to know, whom they contact, you know. So whenever I'm visiting, at least they have one contact person. So they can, you know, so they sometimes they call me, and then they talk and they share their issues, what is happening in their village or maybe family and their personal life, this thing. So it is also very helpful when I'm visiting village to village, and at least they are getting one person with whom they can share these things, which their even parents and family and village peoples are not understanding. So these kind of activities I'm trying to do in my area, and trying to document this all struggle and this worldview which I'm getting, you know, from grassroots. So how I can share with this new generation Adivasi, who those who are in city, you know, and disconnected with these roots. So I'm writing, sharing this Adivasi worldview, sharing thoughts, sharing, you know, experience, and I'm writing articles also, and now I have started writing stories also, and I'm writing poems also continuously. So in this way also I'm trying to give that message, not only Adivasi but other people also, so they can understand, you know, our worldview.
Thank you, Jacinta. Actually, you talked about the connection. So connection in all its forms brings power. So connection between the people, connection between the cultures, yeah. connection between anything, between everything. So I come to my question. Giorgia also was talking about this. We would like to ask you, which is the connection so between your poems mm-hmm. and between us? By reading your poems and by looking also at your activities, it's inevitable that we look back at our own experiences, of course, in Italy, and in particular in our two regions, but there are several examples in all Italy and all over the world. But, for example, we were thinking about Veneto and Lombardia. For example, in Veneto, at the moment, there are some the marketization of land has found its way in an area which is safeguarded by UNESCO, actually, which are the hills of Prosecco. What is Prosecco? Is a typical wine of this area. It's very, very important here. Mm-hmm. And what happened was deforestation, land clearing by people who only seek for earning money and for the profit. And another example is in the city where I come from, in Lecco, in Lombardia. But at the moment, there are some enterprises of excavation in our mountains. So, for example, the mountains, the mountain in question is called Magnodeno, which was excavated and which where the enterprises now also want to keep on with the excavation. But fortunately, some young people are fighting for this to prevent these damages. Not only for nature, not only for the mountains, but are said damages to people, because when you hurt nature, you hurt humans.
Yeah, humanity. Yeah.
It's interconnected. So we have been discussing actually with you in this hour about the interconnection between nature, between
yeah. So sometimes when I talk about this connection, you know, sometimes when I say this connection word, people, those who live in city, and they think I'm talking about networking, you know. So they think I'm talking about networking, but you know, but this connection is very, very like inner connection, outer connection. So Adivasi people, you know, about this connection, they feel like without words also, you know, without words also, sometimes you can understand others which doesn't have a voice. Then also you can understand, you know, their language, you know, their problems, their like that, because nature is not talking the way humans are talking and, you know, sharing. But so those people who have so many language, beautiful language, powerful language, you know, dominant class have powerful language, but why they are unable to talk or understand, you know, nature's language? So that is connection. Mm-hmm. They have lost that connection, so they are unable to understand you know, and what is happening now in you see this whole COVID-19, nobody is understanding what is exactly happening, why we have lost that, because we have lost that connection which we can, you know, understand what is exactly happening, you know, with whole humanity. So this, like, now humans have that lost that connection, what is going to happen, what will happen to humans and humanity, people are unable to understand. And Adivasi talk about that connection without word also, without language also. When there was nothing, then also they had a strong connection with nature, strong connection with community, strong connection with, you know, community, you know. Now we are trying to be single, yeah. So in whole world we are truly becoming single, who has lost, you know, every connection, and everybody is focusing on, you know, networking. So the single people, the single persons network, but there is no connection. So that's why Adivasi people talk about, you know, community, because one person can understand, one person can feel whole community, and whole community can feel what is happening with one person, you know. So now we talk about this, you know, nation, but nation is unable to understand one human being, and one human being is unable to understand this nation, what is happening. So when I talk, you know, this connection, there is no need to understand connection with words or your language. There is only silence, you know, only emptiness, with this silence, emptiness, you know, you can understand this connection. And what happens, like, when Adivasi doesn't talk, they don't use that much word. They, in silence, they try to see, you know, some sign, what nature is trying to give. And when I talk about this sign, you know, then this so-called mainstream people think, like, I'm talking about myth, or, you know, this, it is not logical or something. When I talk about this, about sign, nature is giving sign, and Adivasi people understand that sign. So this university people thinks I'm talking, you know, about unlogical things. So they don't believe that what is sign. If that is scientific, that okay, that sign we believe. That Adivasi, that is spirituality, always mainstream people and this religion, organized religion also, they have suppressed this Adivasi spirituality. There is God and is human and nature, still they are very much together. So you can't define this is God and this is, you know, nature and this is human being. You can't separate them. That's why they are unable to become organized religion. Still, people are snatching them here and there in organized religion, you know. Still, people are not getting one definition of a religion for Adivasi people, because still in Adivasi community, God, nature, humans are very, very close, and their worship is not they are worshiping, they are thanksgiving also, but there is dialogue, you know. They are, when they talk in their festivals, main that ceremony, it happens only discussion with nature. So, you know, so what nature is saying and what I'm understanding, they talk. And when they will understand that, okay, what nature is saying, then slowly that rituals will, you know, will come to end. So that discussion, goes. That this all thing, connection and this spirituality, because of this scientific region also, or maybe this educated world, they never understand that how with this silence people make connection with nature. But this is the core things, you know, this emptiness, this silence, this is the biggest reality of nature. And that's why sometimes to understand you when you live in forest with people, they won't question you much, you know. One day without question, without language, you can be with them and they will understand everything, you know. They will ask you like that, you know, let's go, we have to eat like that. But then also you will feel one kind of, you know, calm and one kind of connection that without language, without word also, everybody is understanding you. And they won't question that, what's your name, you know. Like few days, even 1 week, they won't ask me anything. So they won't know your name or maybe your from where you come. But then also that you feel that one kind of connection is there. So that kind of connection we have with nature. And we get like this kind of sign, you know. And that sign is also sometimes it is very, very, very scientific. But science has made one boundary, you know. Apart that, they don't believe that this is, you know, they say this is myth. But for Adivasi people, this living reality is bigger than science for them. That is, you know, because their experience with nature, they feel like that is true, that they feel. So very closely they observe what small creatures are doing, you know. Like there is a white ant. So when these white ants run fast, so Adivasi people says, okay, rain will come, you know. So this kind of sign they see in nature, and really it is very scientific, and it happens. Or when, you know, so when color of leaves change, they feel like, you know, something is missing, something is wrong happening, you know. So they see very closely, and they can tell you like that. And I don't believe in one land they were searching water, and they have made through bamboo something, one stick, and they were searching water. And I was thinking, this with this bamboo, how can they know where is water, you know, under the but where is water? That bamboo started, you know, it is moving in, you know, differently. And then they said, there is water. And I said, means maybe it can't be true, you know. But when they dig, there was water. So they have this kind of technology, and they have this kind of experience with nature. And still, like mountain, hills, and this land, and then trees, they feel like, you know, they have soul, they have spirit. And without talking them, without getting their answer, without getting their acceptance, we can't, you know, we can't do anything. So when they dig well also, if mud is not, you know, good, first they pray to land. And when they make some pond or maybe well, and if mud is not good, they believe that land is not happy, you know. So they change. No. Land is, you know, sister is not happy, mother is not happy, you know. This mountain, some mountain is like father, some mother or some sister. So they say, no, this mountain is not happy because, you know, when we prayed and then we did land, and that we didn't get, you know, good, we are getting sign that she is not happy. So this kind of connection, this kind of relation, only it will come, you know, only it will come with that kind of connection which Adivasi people have with this nature and humanity, and, you know, and they believe that every, and I feel it is very true that everything is so much connected, whether it is very small, whether it is big, or, you know, everything is very connected. And as human being also, we are so much connected, whether we are in, you know, any part of the world, how we are connected. And we don't believe that, not language, but that feelings, that, you know, oneness, that kind of feeling, it gives you it gives you sense that you can be yourself also, but you can be in community also, you know. So that kind of connection people are losing because of this education system, because you know, this whole modern education also, I don't feel it is giving that connection. It is breaking that connection. So we are trying to how we will come out, whatever we have accumulated knowledge, how we will come out with that knowledge and that kind of understanding, and how we can get new understanding and new worldview from Adivasi people. So as Adivasi young generation, we are understanding that we are going back to roots. We are trying to spend time with people. We are trying to learn. And my many friends have changed, you know, their way, their life, everything. And they feel like now what we are living, whether we don't have that much money, whether we don't have, you know, permanent house, then also, you know, we have that connection with nature, with people, and one kind of happiness, you know, like that. So.
Thank you, Jacinta. I think that the key argument, I mean, this key topic about connection that you explained, I don't have words actually to say what I felt when you were talking about connection, because too often I wonder with myself seeing the society around me, and I get to see that everyone here lost this connection, and you were saying because of education, because of school, because of all these shops and all this, because all this life becomes like a big lie.
Yeah.
A big lie. Everything that we build, we believe is stable, it's permanent, it's there forever, but we don't understand its essence. Yeah. Which is a lie, actually. So thank you very much, because it's really important. And now we would finish our, before, if someone has some questions, we will answer at the end of this. And we will finish this conversation while reading some of your poems. If you can read us your poems in Hindi, and we will translate it in Italian.
So one poem I'm going to read. Maybe in a beginning I have chose another poem, because that was not Vapsi, but because of this white paper I have put, it is all white, and I have chosen another. So this I would like to read this poem because that kind of situation we are facing and world is facing today. And before that, I have read this poem, and one of my friends said, that, do you believe that it can happen? I said, so, you know, like that. So, Vapsi, थोड़ा समय चाहिए धरती को, और एक दिन मुक्त कर लेगी वह खुद को तुम्हारे नियमों से, भर लेगी अपने सारे घाव, उगा लेगी फिर से हरियाली, बुला लेगी फिर से लुप्त हो चुकी आदिम सभ्यताओं को, और लुप्त हो चुकी उनकी भाषाओं।
Ritorno. Alla terra serve solo del tempo, e un giorno libererà se stessa dalle tue leggi e le tue regole, curerà tutte le sue ferite, ricoprirà nuovamente le terre di verde. Invocherà ancora le civiltà antiche inabissate nell'oblio e le loro lingue abbandonate all'estinzione.
Mai nahi janta apne pados ko bhi theek se. Meri kalpna mein rehta hai samaj jiske liye main ladta hu.
Non lo so. Non conosco fino in fondo nemmeno il mio vicino di casa. Un'idea di società vive nella mia mente, e per questa io lotto.
And this is Admi ki bhasha. पहाड़ पर बैठा अकेला देखता हूँ कैसे पेड़ की डाली धीरे से छुआती है पत्तों को अपने सीने से, जैसे माँ बढ़ते बच्चे से छुड़ा रही हो दूध अपना। हजारों उड़ते पत्तों में से एक पत्ता अचानक ठहर जाता है करीब मेरे, जैसे बतियाना चाहता हो मुझसे दो जहान की बातें। तब मौन मेरी आत्मा सुनने लगती है उसकी बातें, और इस तरह मौन देखता है दो आत्माएं कैसे बतिया रही दो जहान की बातें। नहीं हो पाती दर्ज जो कभी किसी दस्तावेज में, और जो दस्तावेजों में शब्दों की भीड़ भरने में व्यस्त हैं, उनके शब्द आज तक नहीं समझ सके क्यों आदमी नहीं समझ पाता आदमी की भाषा।
La lingua umana. Solo, seduto in cima a una montagna, guardo come il ramo di un albero fa cadere piano piano le foglie dal suo petto, come una madre che toglie il proprio latte al bimbo che cresce. Una delle mille foglie che turbinano nel vento all'improvviso si ferma presso di me, come volesse fare due chiacchiere sulle cose del mondo. E allora la mia anima muta si mette ad ascoltare le sue parole, e così il silenzio osserva come conversano due anime dei loro mondi diversi. Una conversazione che non si è mai potuta registrare in un documento storico. E quelli che sono intenti a riempire documenti con mucchi di parole, quelle parole non le possono capire. Perché l'umanità non riesce a capire proprio la lingua umana?
पहाड़ी बांसों का रहस्य। मैं कुरुआ में सो रहा था, अचानक जमीन हिलने लगी। देखा जमीन उखाड़ती मशीन के पंजों पर अपने खेत को। उस टुकड़े के साथ मैं भी लटका था मशीन पर। तब महसूस हुआ मुझे अपनी जमीन सहित उखड़ जाने का डर। मेरे पूर्वजों की देह टुकड़ों में काटी जा रही थी। मैंने देखा उन्हें करोड़ों में बिकते हुए। खरीदारों की भीड़ नीचे शहर बन गई थी। लगा मेरे ही शरीर का हिस्सा कतरों में बिक रहा। पीढ़ियों का भविष्य पहाड़ों की तलहटी में बेच रहा था बांस। तब छूटते ही मशीन के पंजों से मैंने उठा लिया बांस। इस बार ये बांस बाजार नहीं जाएंगे, जंगलों के अंदर वे बनेंगे हर हाथ का तीर धनुष। तब पहली बार समझ में आया पूर्वजों के रक्त से सिंचित पहाड़ों पर उगे असंख्य बांसों का रहस्य।
Il segreto del bambù della foresta. Mentre dormivo nei campi, sui pendii rubati alla foresta, la terra tremò all'improvviso e io vidi il mio campo sulla benna di una scavatrice. Appeso a quella macchina non c'era solo quel pezzo di terra, c'ero anch'io. E allora provai, insieme alla mia terra, il dolore di essere sradicato. Vidi il corpo dei miei antenati, fatto a pezzi, e i lotti venduti a cifre milionarie. La schiera degli acquirenti laggiù era diventata una città, e mi sembrava che fosse proprio il mio corpo essere smembrato e messo all'asta. Ai piedi delle montagne si vendeva bambù, il futuro delle nuove generazioni. Mi liberai dalla presa delle macchine e afferrai una canna di bambù. Questi bambù non saranno più messi in vendita. Questa volta resteranno nella foresta e diventeranno arco e frecce per ogni mano. E allora, per la prima volta, capii il segreto delle innumerevoli canne di bambù, coltivate sulle montagne e irrigate dal sangue degli antenati.
Shabd banta mahua ka phool. Bahurangi chadar lapete ek saath sare shabd. बढ़ रहे थे गांव की ओर, तोड़ते सने के फूलों को, नोचते कोयनार के पत्तों को। तभी मिट्टी के घर से अकेली मुस्कुराती हुई संस्कृति निकली, हाथ में लेकर कासे की थाली, थोड़ा सरसों का तेल, थोड़ा पानी, और झूम उठा अपनेपन से गांव, रंगीन शब्दों के धुने को पान। अचानक शब्दों के रंग उड़ने लगे, पहली बार धरती से जैसे जुड़ने लगे। कहते रहे क्या क्या गए हैं हम भूल, तभी गिरा वहां एक महुआ का फूल। छूकर उसे रह गए सब स्तब्ध, वो बन रहा था धीरे धीरे पृथ्वी का एक अर्थपूर्ण शब्द।
Un fiore di mahua trasformato in parola. Avvolte in scialli variopinti, tutte le parole avanzavano verso il villaggio, raccogliendo un fiore di Sanai qui, una foglia di Koinar là. Allora la cultura uscì sorridendo dalla sua casa di fango solitaria, tenendo in mano un piatto di rame, un po' d'olio di senape, dell'acqua e il villaggio, in un impeto di affetto accorse alla variepiedi delle parole. Improvvisamente le parole sbiancarono, come sentissero per la prima volta il legame con la terra. Ed esclamarono più e più volte: Oh, come abbiamo potuto dimenticare! In quel momento un fiore di Mahu cadde dall'albero. Il suo tocco rilasciò tutte di sasso, perché piano piano il fiore si trasformava in una parola significativa dell'essenza della terra.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I would just see if we have some questions, and we will be happy to hear all your answers. And I see some comments actually. Lahia Jajwaya Sapute, she says, I do agree with you. People are actually losing the connection with nature as they are being taught more about materialistic aspects and materialistic gains instead of living in balance with nature and society. So this is actually true.
I completely agree with you, Judge Valia.
Just a second, I would like to see if there are some questions, other questions, and then if there are no questions, we can we can close here, and because we already talked with you enough and took your time, actually.
We have a comment by Francesco De Bonis, who is telling you, Jacinta, thank you very much, Jacinta, your poems are wonderful.
Thank you, thank you.
If there are not other comments,
we can close here. And if someone has some question, maybe we can write it to you later and you can answer anytime.
Yes.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Jacinta.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Johar.
Johar.